Patriots.
Okay, great.
Nice to meet you.
Actually, yes. Joe Brothers is I helped him when he ran for state chair. And got to know him, you know, during his run for that. And then when I announced this week, I called him and connected to him and said, hey, Republican meeting, second meeting, you know, second Wednesday, second Thursday of every month. And he said, come on over. So we made that decision late yesterday. And here
I went.
So Greg, what made you decide to jump into the Senate race?
What made feet there in Washington. I don't.
Who's that?
No.
No, we can take him out.
I think we can retire.
Yeah.
I think we're in a good shape. We need to clean the Senate. We definitely got to get a totally.
You think you can do it?
I know I can do it.
All right.
Yes, ma'am. You know, let me tell you why I did this. You know, I don't know if you folks have had any opportunity to read anything about me. There's a website out there, www.meller2012.com, and it'll have everything you ever want to know, probably more, about who I am. And what you'll find there is I'm a restaurant guy. I grew up in the restaurant business. I started at 13 as a dishwasher over in Rockledge, Florida. And, how you doing, Doctor?
Great.
Nice to see you.
Boss. Good.
Yeah, good. I'm coming.
I'll be back. That's all right. I can hear you fine.
That's okay. I don't want to have my back on. And my last job, I kind of went from running, being involved in casual restaurants, because I joined Red Lobster in the very early days of that company. After coming out of the U.S. Air Force, I was a military veteran and volunteered to go to Vietnam back
military?
In 69.
Right. That's what we need. That's what we need. We need military, because he's been running on military.
You know, it's not about necessarily just things like volunteering to go in the military or volunteering to go to Vietnam. I tell people it's about what kind of life's experiences have you had that qualify you to go up and represent people. And what I find, and one of the reasons I'm in this race, is I look at the people that have decided to enter the race for the U.S. Senate, and I see a bunch of career politicians. And there's nothing wrong with being in politics, okay? But when I think about what makes you qualified to do something like this, to represent folks like you, is what have you done with your life? Where do your experiences come from? You know, what have you volunteered to do? How have you been engaged in the community? And if you spent your whole professional career running for public office and being in public office, that means you never signed the front of a check. You never had to lay anybody off. You never had to talk to someone about doing a better job if they want to keep the job. You know, you've never done the types of things that people in the real world, in what I call it, what I've kind of named it, is never been on Main Street. I've always been on Pennsylvania Avenue or maybe Monroe Street up in Tallahassee, but never been on Main Street. And I've lived my whole life on Main Street. My mom was a telephone operator. My dad worked at NASA at the Cape. He had been orphaned when he was 8. My mother came from a sharecropper family in South Carolina. And they raised me to be self-reliant. You know, when you expected to get some type of a financial reward, it was usually a nickel. And so that's what made me have to go out and get a job when I was 13. All my friends were wearing these little shirts with these little alligators on it, and I wanted one. Okay, so. After I kind of finished my restaurant career, I spent 40 years. I spent 11 years with Darden, which was Red Lobster in that company. Then I built the Pizzeria Uno chain. I was there for 17 years, Chicago deep dish pizza. I still carry some of the problem with that. And then my last job was president and CEO of Bruce Chris Steakhouse. And so I kind of went up the food chain. I also got involved with the National Restaurant Association about 15 years ago. Spent some time on the board of directors there, and that's a large organization that represents a big group of restaurant business is 935,000, and about 14 million employees. And what we did at the Restaurant Association, which I then went through that ranks and became its chairman in 05 and 06. And the time on the National Restaurant Association board was help me get involved and be more proactive in pro-business, smaller government, you know, workforce issues, having to deal with the real pain that comes from having to deal with a broken immigration system. And so all of that experience, and then when I left Ruth's Chris, I didn't want to run restaurants anymore. When you've had your hands in as much hot water as I had, I don't want to do it anymore. You know? And so I decided that, you know, I was going to try my shot at making a difference in Washington. What you'll find on my website is I ran for Congress in District 24. I got in that race early last year. Got in late, and our goal for our campaign was to retire Suzanne Cosmas in the Congress, a Democrat from Volusia County. Mm-hmm. And I came up 1,600 votes short in the primary. But it was a very close race. It was a learning experience for me. And I'm not a quitter. I'm not discouraged at all by what we did. I learned a great deal. And the most important thing I've learned is something that I felt inside of me was that I can connect with the American people. I can connect with Main Street. I can connect with people that are hurting. When you are in the service business, as I have, and you spent your whole life talking to people, employees going out the back door and guests coming in the front door, you learn what's going on. And you also get experiences about how you work with people, how you get things happen, make things happen. You got to put a good menu together. If you've got a bad menu, people aren't going to come back. You also don't manage your business from crisis to crisis to crisis. It's so disturbing to see where we are today when you think about the fact, and just step back for a moment and say, why are we always in such angst and in such crisis? But are we talking about this debt problem for years, okay? We're finally, the American people and the people of Florida have stepped up to say enough, okay? We all know that if we don't do something about this debt, we can't borrow money to write checks to people. And that's what we're doing. Okay, so we got to get our house in order, just like every American family has had to do that. And I want to take those life experiences to Washington, and that's why I'm here.
How did the you're in the restaurant business? There's a lot of, you know, minimum wage jobs in the kitchen and whatnot, and in that kind
entry
of thing.
Entry level
things.
Right.
You mentioned the whole illegal immigration problem. Sure. How did that affect you directly in your business? How did you deal with it?
Well, first of all, you got to understand that I come from a viewpoint that laws need to be respected, and respect for the law is critical to me. And if you got bad laws, you try to influence the changing of those laws, you don't break them, okay? I remember something Abraham Lincoln said. He said, if you got a bad law, enforce it aggressively, and people will figure out how to change it, okay? And whether it's a 55-mile-an-hour speed limit, okay, it should be higher, okay? So if you can't enforce something, or it's very difficult to enforce, you gotta step back a moment and say to yourself, maybe there's something about these laws that we need to make changes. As a restaurateur, as someone that employs thousands and thousands of people and has to make decisions on who to hire and who to fire, you quickly learn that the system is so broken. Let me just give you an example. You don't know whether you hired an illegal alien until you hired him.
Really?
Okay? Yes, ma'am. You don't know it until you hired him. Okay? No. It's discrimination. You can ask. But you don't know whether they are or not, because people don't always tell you the truth. Okay?
They don't have to prove this is true.
They can show you a fake ID, they can give you some document, they can say their name is Jackie Bourne, and that they were, you know, they can tell you all kinds of things. Okay. Now, a few years ago, the federal government decided to embark on a voluntary program called e-verification. Okay. Also, and after Reagan's presidency in mid-1980s, when we essentially did the amnesty thing under Ronald Reagan, okay, and the whole idea that Reagan had was that they were going to get a clean slate, and now we're going to pass a law, so you've got to give information. and they came out what's called an I-9 form. They can get you an I-9 form. They better have them back there. I'm sure they do. Okay, if you go and get a job, you give them certain information. You give your employer certain information. Social Security number, date of birth, place of birth, all that stuff you collect. The government came out with a voluntary program called e-verification that takes that data off of an I-9 form and encodes it into a data bank, two data banks. One goes to Social Security Administration to make sure there's a match between the name and the Social Security number. The other one goes to Homeland Security. Okay, this was post 9/11 that this came about, okay? But it was voluntary. I have been a proponent, in fact, I testified in Washington about 3 weeks ago, to make this a mandatory program, okay? Now, some states have been trying to, the Arizona law, you heard a lot about, Florida didn't pass a new verification law last session. In 2006, when I was CEO of Ruth's Chris, when it first became available, I adopted it at Ruth's Chris. I put the verification in my company. Why? Okay. Because as a law-abiding business person, okay, if someone offers me a tool that allows me to do a better job of doing my job, okay, I'm going to do it. Unfortunately, there's 7.2 million businesses in this country. There's only 270,000 businesses that use the program.